Hello friends, welcome back to my channel. So today in this video we are going to discuss about case based questions related to COVID-19 and the diagnosis part of COVID-19. What questions could be asked in the NEET MDS 2022? This presentation could also be very useful for those who are going to appear for Army Dental Corps interview, and also for those who are going to appear for any interviews related to dental officers post, as this is a very recent topic and the questions which are included in this presentation are really high yield. Okay, so this is my request to you all that please pull out your notebook and note it down. Okay, it's not just the question and answer, but in detail explanation are also given into this presentation. So whenever required, just pause this video and note it down from the explanation if you find that this information is new to you. If you have not subscribed to my channel yet, then please do subscribe it now and also hit the like button. If I'll get 200 likes in 24 hours, then I will consider that you guys have liked this video, and I will create more such videos on mucormycosis case related and, you know, COVID-19. There are other topics in COVID-19 itself from which such questions could be asked, right? So now, any further ado, let's start the video. So the classical triad of commonest COVID-19 symptoms include fever, sore throat, running nose, fever, loss of smell, fatigue, fever, cough, shortness of breath, or fever, loss of taste, or sore throat. It is quite confusing, right? But the correct answer is fever, cough, and shortness of breath. Now let's see that the most common symptoms in hospitalized patients are: fever is seen in up to 90% of the patient, dry cough in 60 to 86%, and shortness of breath in 53 to 80% of the patients. And that's why these three are most common symptoms for COVID-19. Please note down the key concept over here as well. If you are a NEET MDS aspirant and searching for a coaching or online platform, then Meritors is the one application which I would like to suggest you all, because it is the number one resource for NEET MDS, INICT MDS and PDS, the link of which is in the description box below, guys. Please do check it out. The material and the test series which they create, the questions which they create, are very much similar to your NEET pattern. And in the last few NEET and AIMS exams, they have got the strike rate of 90%. Yes. And so many dental students have already downloaded this app and they are already using it. So if you have not checked it out yet, the link is in the description box below. Please do download it and check it out. So what is the difference between influenza-like illness and severe acute respiratory infection according to WHO? So you should know the specific guidelines for the ILI and SARI, okay? So option A is need for hospitalization in SARI, symptoms of cough in SARI, duration of onset in 10 days in SARI, or history of fever more than or equal to 38 degrees Celsius. So the difference is need for hospitalization is required in SARI. So these are the definitions given by WHO for influenza-like illness and severe acute respiratory infection. A patient aged 60 with systolic blood pressure greater than 200 mm of Hg presented with drowsiness and lethargy. The respiratory rate was greater than 25. The patient is suspected to be COVID positive. So how will you classify this patient according to NEWS2? Now what is NEWS2? If you don't know what is NEWS2, you cannot attempt this question, right? So let's see that what is this. It is a protocol for treatment of confirmed COVID-19, pre-hospitalized and hospitalized patients, identification and warning score. Okay, so NEWS stands for National Early Warning Score. So this whole table is important for you. Okay, just see what all parameters are there and what are the values you have to keep in mind. It is a very important topic, so do note it down and memorize it as well. A patient with acute upper respiratory tract infection presented to the COVID care center. The symptoms include fever, cough, and myalgia. How would you classify this patient based on these clinical findings? Whether the patient is very mild, mild, moderately mild, or moderate. Such kind of options will be given to you just to confuse you, okay? Basically, in the classification, there is no thing as very mild or moderately mild. Okay, there is only mild, moderate, severe, and critical. So this is the classification of COVID-19 patients based on clinical features. You should know it thoroughly. Moving to the next question, a person is considered to be a confirmed case of COVID-19. Okay, so this is also a very tricky part, that confirmed case, probable case, suspected case. So there are specific guidelines to diagnose or categorize a COVID-19 cases as confirmed or suspected, right? So when you call a case as a confirmed case of COVID-19, whether the patient is positive on RT-PCR, positive SARS-CoV-2 antigen, or asymptomatic patient with positive SARS-CoV-2 antigen. So when the patient has all of these three, you call the patient as confirmed case of COVID-19. Okay, so these are the guidelines for confirmed cases according to Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So please do note it down and remember as well. See, now this question here, they are asking about probable case. A patient is considered to be a probable case of COVID-19 in all of the following cases except, okay? So here again, let's look at the guidelines. What are the probable cases when we call a probable case of COVID-19? First of all, a patient who meets clinical criteria above and is a contact of a probable or confirmed case or linked to a COVID-19 cluster. Secondly, a suspect case with chest imaging showing findings suggestive of COVID-19. So, chest imaging. A person with recent onset of anosmia or agusia in the absence of any other identified causes, or death not otherwise explained in an adult with respiratory distress preceding death, and in an adult with respiratory distress preceding death and was a contact of a probable or confirmed case or linked to a COVID-19 cluster. So here our answer will be residing or working in an area with high risk of transmission. Apart from these, all could be the probable case for COVID-19. A patient is considered to be a suspected cases of COVID-19 if he or she has. So again, you should know what are the guidelines for suspected cases, okay? So here are the guidelines for suspected cases. So from this, acute onset of fever, cough, and headache is considered to be a suspected case of COVID-19. This is very important, guys. Confirmed case, suspected case, okay? So remember it and write it down. A patient who appears to be normal despite of low SpO2 levels is shown to suffer from silent hypoxia, hypoxic hypoxia, happy hypoxia, or silent and happy hypoxia both. Now hypoxia is an important topic for us over here, okay? So the points which are important related to hypoxia are enlisted here. So please go through it. Now the next question is, match the following clinical cases with their treatment protocols. Okay, now if your SpO2 is 90 to 93%, so what could be the treatment protocol? Oxygen support, anti-inflammatory, anti-coagulation, and monitoring is required. Okay, when the respiratory rate is more than 30 per minute, so in that case, we'll provide oxygen support, anti-inflammatory, anticoagulation, supportive measures, and monitoring. When the upper respiratory tract infection without hypoxia is there, so in such cases, we will do the symptomatic treatment and will also give the inhalational budesonide. So our option over here is B. Now here is a detailed chart, okay? Through which you can decide ki whether the disease is mild, moderate, or severe, and how the complete protocol should be followed for COVID-19 patient. Now coming to the diagnosis part, okay, confirmatory diagnosis of COVID-19 is done by, I think this is very easy question, it is done by PCR of nasopharyngeal swab. The commonest laboratory abnormality seen following hemogram of a critically ill COVID-19 patient is what? commonest laboratory abnormality which is seen is lymphopenia. Okay, so lymphopenia is seen in 83% of the cases, and abnormal coagulation parameters like prolonged prothrombin time, thrombocytopenia, elevated D-dimer and low fibrinogen is also commonly seen in hospitalized patients. Characteristic feature of opacities or consolidation seen in X-ray chest of a COVID-19 patient is what? It is a ground glass appearance. Okay, I'm not sure if you guys have seen such chest X-ray of any COVID-19 patient or what, but yes, the appearance is ground glass appearance. See, here in this X-ray you can clearly make it out. Okay, which of the following diagnostic tests yield higher number of false negative COVID-19 results? So it is option number C, lateral flow immunoassays. It leads to maximum number of false negative cases. Again, this is a very important slide for all of you, so please pause this video and note this down. Here through this chart it is clear that the maximum false results are achieved through lateral flow immunoassays. And one more concept which you need to clear over here is, what do you mean by false positive and false negative? False positive means that the results say you have the condition, you have COVID-19, but you really don't. And when it is false negative, the result says you don't have a condition, you don't have COVID-19, but you really do. The test says no, but you really do. Antibody detection following a COVID-19 history helps in what? It helps in detecting susceptible individuals. Yes, it helps in identifying individuals with neutralizing antibodies. Yes, and it also facilitates in contact tracing. So all of the above. I think this is an easy question for you all. So again, this is a chart which I think you should note down. Okay, which of the following is an incorrect match regarding the positive result interpretation of various tests for detection of coronavirus? Antigen test. So what happens? Virus surface protein present in the sample, virus RNA present in sample does not indicate if it is viable. And serology, antibodies against virus present in blood shows the past infection. So which of the following is incorrect match? I think all of these are correct matches. Okay, so our option will be none of the above. Now these are the quite few points about the RT-PCR antigen test and antibody tests. Okay, while collecting a nasopharyngeal swab sample, for how long should one rub the swab in each nostril? For how many seconds we should rub? 15 seconds. I hope you all know this thing. So this is the swab collection method and few of the details related to the sample collection. False about Feluda is, now first we should know what is Feluda is. Okay, it is FNCA-S9 editor linked uniform detection assay. Is a newly approved method based on CRISPR gene editing technology to identify and target the genetic material of SARS-CoV-2. Only if we know these much details we can attempt questions like this. Okay, so what is false about Feluda? So let's study Feluda in detail. Okay, it's a faster than RT-PCR. Okay, then it is very affordable, sensitive, okay, 96% of the time, and it is 98% specific strip test which can detect viral genetic material within 45 minutes, whereas our RT-PCR takes longer than this. So it has been developed in India and approved by CSIR to aid diagnosis of SARS. So what is false about Feluda now? It is the acronym for FNCA-S9 editor linked uniform detection assay. Yes, it is. Then it is based on CRISPR gene editing technology. Yes, it is slower than RT-PCR. No, it is faster than RT-PCR. So our option is C, and yes, it was developed in India. Now, Corey's bio concept requires which laboratory setup? Now, first we should know what is this Corey's bio concept, right? So, guidance for use of COVID-19 antigen respiratory strip, which is Corey's bio concept, okay? All the important points regarding this Corey's bio concept are given on the slide. And after that, we can decide that which laboratory setup is required for Corey's bio concept. So, it is BSL-2 is required. Which of the following statement is not true about serologic testing for SARS-CoV-2? Measures the amount of antibodies produced, determines if a person was previously infected, diagnostic tool in symptomatic individuals, or both A and B. So which of the following is not true? Diagnostic tool in symptomatic individuals is incorrect. Let's see the details of it. Serologic test should not be used to diagnose acute SARS-CoV-2 infection as antibodies develop a few weeks after the infection. Now, the advantages of using the rapid antigen test are, it is rapid availability of results, high specificity, high confirmatory values, or high sensitivity. So, what are the advantages of rapid antigen test? It is rapid availability of the results and high specificity. Okay, one more concept which you should clear over here is specificity and sensitivity. Okay, so these are the few key points related to rapid antigen, so please do note it down. Indications of diagnostic test for COVID-19 include testing people who have symptoms consistent with COVID-19 and who present to their healthcare provider, testing people as a result of contact tracing efforts, testing people who indicate that they were exposed to someone with a confirmed or suspected case of COVID-19, or testing people who attended an event where another attendee was later confirmed to have COVID-19. Now, such questions require a great amount of time and thinking, especially when you are under pressure and, you know, when you are under tension. But that's why it is always advisable to keep your calm and just read the questions very clearly so that you can reach to the correct answer quickly. So, indications for diagnostic test for COVID-19 include all of the above, A, B, C and D. In all these cases, we will indicate the diagnostic test. Indications of screening test include, screening test kab karayenge? Testing people who have symptoms consistent with COVID-19 and who present to their healthcare provider, testing people as a result of contact tracing efforts, testing people who indicate that they were exposed to someone with a confirmed or suspected case of COVID-19, or testing at home for someone who does not have symptoms associated with COVID-19 and no known exposures to someone with COVID-19. So, screening test is included in this scenario where the testing at home for someone who does not have symptoms associated with COVID-19 and no known exposure to someone with COVID-19. So, here is the explanation. All of the following can be used as swab for NAAT, except laryngeal swab is not used, right? It is easy. Saliva, oropharyngeal and nasal works as a swab. Which test is carried out for a COVID-19 patient after 14 days of quarantine? Okay, so for person with COVID-19, testing is not recommended to determine when infection has resolved, when to end home isolation, or whether to discontinue precautions in a healthcare setting. NAATs have detected SARS-CoV-2 RNA in some people's respiratory specimens long after they have recovered from COVID-19, which was even after 3 months. So no test is carried out for a COVID-19 patient after 14 days of quarantine, okay?